good Thursday morning. On behalf of KPCC and Southern California Public Radio, welcome to the Crawford Family Forum. Today, in our Drucker Business Forum, we're talking about mindfulness, where business and the behavioral sciences intersect. Please welcome our guests, Jeremy Hunter and Nick Udall.
Good morning. Good morning. Thank you for braving traffic on a Thursday morning to come be with us. I'd like to thank Janice and all her team for her really generous support in our oftentimes unreasonable requests in terms of how we'd like to do this. I'd like to thank the Drucker School for sponsoring this and making this possible, making my work possible, this grand experiment of over now 12 years of helping educate executives about their own mind. And I'd like to thank my friend Nick Udall, who flew all the way from London to be with us. So it's been a really thrilling week. In the spirit of Janice's questions, how many people have a mindfulness practice? Wow. And how many people have heard of mindfulness and not quite sure what it is? And okay, interesting. How many people have never heard of mindfulness and were brought here against your will? One person, okay, great. We have some gifts for you in the lobby. So as Janice mentioned earlier, you know, we in thinking about how to put this together, we didn't want to just be two talking heads talking, you know, at each other, and you have the great privilege of watching. We wanted to make this an interactive event. We wanted to involve you and make this, for us, this is also an experiment. So we wanted to involve you in the experiment as well. And so we have some thoughts about maybe what we'd like you to do.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Before we're going to introduce ourselves a bit more, but before we do, I'd like to elaborate on this idea, which is to invite you to participate, which is not going to be scary or anything inappropriate. But for us, mindfulness is not just an individual endeavor, it's a collective endeavor. And when we were playing with what we could do yesterday for today, was how could we bring mindfulness as a collective inquiry into the room rather than we talk about it, which we're going to have to do as well. So our invitation to you is to, if I could just invite you to do some things very quickly. It's going to take 2 or 3 minutes, okay? The first thing we'd like to do is make sure, if you've got a piece of paper available, if you haven't, that's fine, but we think it might be useful through a pen. We want you to pay attention to what's emerging for you over the next 45 minutes. We'd also like you to quickly introduce yourself to the people next to you, so you're in relationship. And if you haven't got someone next to you, find someone next to you, turn round. But just pay attention to who's next to you. And if you know them, find out something else about them. But take in their name. Okay? Quick sense, people around you. Very simply, hopefully you're just that little bit more in relationship. You're not just sitting here on your own, you're realizing that there is space here, people next to you. What we then really encourage you to do is sit in a particular way. If you don't want to do it, don't do it. So this is all optional. But we would highly advise you to sit slightly more upright than slouched, with your feet on the floor, so you can feel the floor. We want to bring mindfulness into the room, very simply, very quickly. Great way of doing this is to soften your shoulders. Get energy into your, soften the shoulders, soften the forehead, soften the palate, and just soften yourself into the space. If the challenge is then, feel into your body. For us, mindfulness that we'll go into is felt through the body. So can you feel your body on the seat, the heaviness of your body, how it's connecting to the seat? Can you feel your relationship to space? You've now met the people next to you. Can you raise your awareness beyond yourself to the people that are next to you? You now know their name. And the challenge then is how to expand your awareness beyond the people next to you and into the room. And if you can try and hold that space through the next 45 minutes, our invitation is to see what emerges by holding that mindfulness. And we will all snap back into our heads, and occasionally we'll try and remember to expand the awareness. What we're particularly wanting you to do in the next 45 minutes, if you so choose, is as we go through it, pay attention to what happens in your body. Imagine yourself as an instrument. When does your energy go up? When does your energy go down? Hopefully it doesn't go down too much, but hopefully, when does it come up? When do you get triggered by something? When do you have a reaction to something that's said, something that's not said, something that goes on in your own head? So how can you hold this awareness so you're just paying attention to what's happening? Raise your attention to noticings. Okay, and we'll come back at the end and see if this experiment works at all. Okay, thank you.
So as you can gather already, our approach to mindfulness and how I've thought about mindfulness in terms of working with executives is not something that's removed, you know, on the mountaintop somewhere else in the meditation hall, but a capacity we bring to perceive clearly what's going on inside us, inside our body, the emotional reactions, the thoughts or narratives we have, and then what's going on around you, right? And how are you in relationship to one another? And because we, you know, I teach at a school of management, we are focused on results. And how is what is happening inside your body, the emotional reactions you have, the narratives that are happening inside, your relationship to space, to the people around you, affecting your action? And how is that action bringing about a result that you may want or you may not want? One of the core principles or core ideas we work with is that most of the time we are operating on automatic pilot. You know, the optimists think 90% of the time we're operating on some kind of non-conscious automated pattern that we don't see. No one ever tells you, oh, by the way, you're operating on autopilot most of the time. Be careful, right? So mindfulness is cultivating the capacity and attention to be able to perceive yourself clearly. Right? And from our point of view, one of our many commonalities, it's to be able to see that in action. Right? And how do you affect change in the world? Or not, right? So for us, mindfulness is a core capacity for working today. It's not something extra, right? But it's the fundamental ground on which all of our action comes from. So with having that said that, as I mentioned, 12 years ago, I developed, about 15 years ago, actually, I developed a set of classes to help managers manage themselves. Peter Drucker talked about the idea of you couldn't manage anything else first unless anything else if you couldn't manage yourself first, right? It seems like such a core basic idea. And yet we had never really developed a practice of self-management. I got into this because I'll be 43 this year. And when I was 20, I was diagnosed with what was supposed to be a terminal illness. The doctor told me I had 90% chance of dying in 5 years. That was in 1992. And, you know, okay, somebody, I don't know if you're 20 years old, were you thinking about your mortality? I know I wasn't. So what do you do? What do you do if someone hands you this kind of sentence in a certain way? And how I chose to deal with it was to understand how my mind worked. I studied Zen. My mother's Japanese, and we had all this stuff lying around the house. And I undertook a practice of trying to see how my mind worked and how my mind influenced how I related to this illness. And to make a long story short, I I'm still alive. fast forward, 20 years or so. Last year, I had the opportunity to co-write a paper, which I think is linked on the website, about mindfulness and how it can be a capacity for leaders to effectively meet adaptive challenges. Adaptive challenges are those kind of challenges that require you to do something different, to develop a new way of operating in the world, right? Which means not operating off of autopilot. And so the capacity to see the world clearly we tend to think of it in terms of health. That's probably where in this culture mindfulness has had its biggest foothold. And of course, that's important. But it also kind of occurred to me in my partner, Michael Chaskelson, in writing this paper that mindfulness had other applications as well, and especially around creativity and adaptation. That paper got into the hands of a common acquaintance of ours who passed it on to Nick. And suddenly, I found myself in dialogue with this man in who lives outside of London, and we had probably one of the most thrilling conversations of my life last year. And we had enormous number of synchronicities in our first, I think we counted at least seven yesterday in that first conversation. And then we had another one, which is equally thrilling. And so our idea for today was to open up that conversation and this kind of ongoing experiment that we have to you, and to involve you in this conversation and try to understand how does this land on you. So, thank you.
So what I want to do is also bring into the room why I'm here, what I'm excited by, what I'm about, because when we get drawing, you'll get a sense of where I'm coming from, because I want to get to the whiteboard. Originally, I was a product designer, so in theory, I can design anything from a toothbrush to a football stadium, and we got very disillusioned with the design world very quickly. I was very struck by how it felt like it had a monopoly on the creative process, and I didn't particularly find them more creative than anyone else. So I wanted to study that, and I did a PhD in creativity and consciousness. And it was particularly around, or my desire to move away from, problem-solving techniques. Because by default, problem-solving techniques are moving away from something you don't want, i.e. the problem, as opposed to my belief that creativity is about moving towards something you do want. It's generative, purposeful. And I became, and in some of our synchronicities, I was also ill when I was a teenager with Crohn's disease. I was in hospital and very severe periods. The meaning of life flashed through me when I was a teenager, which I still haven't found. And I then also studied Zen for 9 years. But in my PhD, it gave me the opportunity to meet mystics, neuroscientists, quantum physicists, business people. And I became interested in the challenge of, can you catalyze moments of true insight and, more importantly, moments of collective breakthrough? And in those moments of breakthrough, you change. So for me, the definition of breakthrough has two components. One is it generates something other than you, an innovation, a product. For example, I used to teach life drawing, and you can help a novice life drawer create something they never thought they could do in 30 minutes. To the extent they will go, I never knew I could do that. So they've created something that you can't argue with, the evidence. In business, that's obviously new value. But I was also just as much interested in the transformational outcome of a breakthrough, i.e. you have changed. You can no longer go back to what you thought before. You have repatterned your thinking, your worldview. So that's really what I dedicated my life to, is learning how to do it. I'm still on the journey. I feel like I've learned a lot, and I've got a lot to go. And we created a business around it called Nowhere, of the words now and here. The only way you can unlock creativity in my mind, in our mind, is to be present, to be still. And we're going to play with that later. And nowhere is really set up about how to build cultures of innovation. How do you make this phenomenon, this ability to dance with the known and the unknown, a cultural phenomenon? And for us, this is beyond high-performance cultures, which unfortunately have fallen into metrics and norms and best practices and kill creativity. So we're interested in how do you create these as cultural forms? What does this mean for leaders to lead in these cultural forms? And that's how we then met through a client who was a very progressive client who was shaping the culture of their bank. And this is how we met. And I'm particularly personally interested, and I suppose this is how I then got connected to the World Economic Forum. I suppose my day job, above and beyond helping organizations transform their cultures and ways of working, is really to shift the consciousness of leaders and senior leadership teams. So I've spent 23 years now working with CEOs of global businesses. I'm interested in big, scary, complex, multi-site, multi-culture systems, rather than campus-based organizations. And how do you work? I mean, I don't know why they started listening to me when I was 23, but for some reason they pay some attention. But I'm interested in how they transform the pattern. How do you create new patterns of thought that lead to new patterns of action, individually and collectively? And I see a big narrative from the World Economic Forum, which is we're having the same old conversations. We can see all the problems out there, all the challenges. We'll talk about the needs in a minute. But we're having circular conversations, and we're still doing the same things. We're not changing our patterns of action. So I'm going to then jump to the whiteboard. So for me, what we've been talking about in the last few weeks is how mindfulness, particularly the ability to be conscious and present, and to be at, which for us is the building block of unlocking something that's new, is what are the needs beyond the narrative that often sits out there and is fantastic, important. Health, stress, paying attention to your body, et cetera, really important part of mindfulness. But what we wanted to bring into the room is the business innovations side of it. Yes, health can make a lot of difference, it can save on healthcare, et cetera, be preventative, but actually the name of the game of growth for businesses is to innovate. The only way to grow is to innovate at every level of the business. We're living in a world of increased change. I'm nervous about even saying that because it sounds like a cliche, but it's also true. Everything is changing. Everything is also becoming more complex. Personally, I love complexity. You have more chance of getting breakthrough in complexity than in something that's a simple system. Also, hyperdependency. Everything is beginning to be ever more connected. I think it always was. We're just becoming more aware of it. So how do we work with hyperdependency? We've got risk, et cetera, I could go on. You go into the really big, super wicked problems of society. How big do you want it to be? Unfortunately, and by definition, we are part of the problem. Okay? So the ability is, what's the creativity challenge in all of these? Because doing what we've always done is not going to get any of these any easier. And they're not nice to haves. This is a necessity. And that's the bit that gets me out of bed. And this is the curve that we wanted to talk through. Is for us, well, for me particularly, innovation is the dance between the known and the unknown. Unfortunately, we are educated around knowledge, known, and are not skilled or not taught how to work with the unknown. Similarly, it's about we are very much as a culture focused on what's conscious as opposed to what's unconscious, or what's visible as opposed to what's currently invisible. Or if we want to get a little bit more extreme, what is explicate? That which is already unfolded, distinguished, and clear, and that which is implicate, it's still enfolded, undistinguished, and interconnected. And what, for me, I'm interested in from a mindfulness perspective is how do you help people ride this roller coaster, this dance? And particularly, below the line when you're moving into the unknown and the unconscious, how do you raise your awareness to what's going on? Because in your working with the unknown, the intellect doesn't play a big part. You have to deploy other ways of knowing. You have to rely on yourself as an instrument, which is why we mentioned it at the beginning. How are you feeling about something? How do you use your body as an instrument? How do you work with intuition? Many other levels of perception. But the problem is, when we go into the unknown, we have the tendency to have a reaction. There's fear, there's frustration, there's risk. We start to judge things, we find excuses. It's unfamiliar. And there are two things that particularly get in the way of staying in that dip. And I go back to what I said earlier about complexity. Complexity and chaos lives in here. And by the very nature of complexity and chaos, it naturally reorders itself if you stay in it long enough. But our tendency is to get out of it as quickly as possible because it's just odd, scary. You have to show our vulnerabilities. And if I was drawing a little roller coaster here, the two carriages that I want to talk about first is there are two things that are likely to collapse this roller coaster back to a flat line. And a flat line is doing what we always do, our habitual patterns. This is what we're familiar. It's easy to snap back to it than to go into the unknown and stay there. And stay there for long enough and stay there with skill. And the two things that are collapse it is me and us. How I react in the moment to something that's unfamiliar, scary, complex, collapses the roller coaster. I can judge it, I can be superior. I can feel a victim of circumstance and snap back to how I used to do. But just as importantly, and what we want to keep bringing into the room, is it's how we are together. If I'm working with a team, it's how any relationship at any moment can collapse that roller coaster. And then you just get back into the circular pattern of doing what you've always done.
So I think in one of our differences is that Nick works with systems, and I work with individuals. So if we are, what we do is to help the participant or the student understand, Nick talked about reverting back to pattern, right? And so we look at how do you as an individual fall into patterns regularly that reproduce results you don't want. And we talked a lot about education. So what do we actually educate in this culture people to do? And it's usually we educate you to take in knowledge, analyze it, and create more knowledge. And of course, nobody's going to argue that that's not useful. But it misses a whole lot of other human capacities that can be trained and developed. So one of them, which I referenced earlier, which is the ability to see. And Drucker talked about this, actually, that we've overtrained people to think and we've undertrained them to see. Right? We don't. And for him, it was about learning how to see this changing world so that you could adapt to it effectively and understand, are your assumptions about the world actually relevant now? Right? So that the actions you take are still useful. I think the other thing that in my latest round of work, what I'm developing now are tools to help people deal with transition, right? And so is there anybody going through a transition in this room, right? Okay. So for me, when we talk about this curve, right, you move from a world that's known, and suddenly, right, you might find yourself out of a job, or your kids leave home, or your company goes through a reorganization, and you have a completely different role. You move from a known world to a completely unknown world, right? And how do you deal with that? Most of us freak out at some level, right? And so what we don't educate is the capacity to not freak out, or the capacity to be freaking out but still staying in the room. So just out of curiosity, as I talked about transition, nervous laughter filled the room. What's happening in your body? Right? What do you notice now? So we educate this capacity to be with the discomfort of not knowing what is going to happen so that you can stay in it long enough so that you start to find threads about what the next step might be. Right? Another aspect of the work is using, so you know, in my world, when we talk about managing oneself, we talk first about how to manage a nervous system. Right? We have this nervous system that is finely tuned to protect us. Right? It wants to help us survive. But that system evolved when for a situation where we were living on a savanna with a lot of wild animals and not a whole lot of stimulation. And then you suddenly fast forward to the 21st century and you're in this intensely social, tight set of very complex relationships and systems, right? And you have this nervous system that's wired to go off at things that it perceives as a threat. Just say budget meeting, right? Notice what happens, right? So we learn the first part, you know, so we talked about stress reduction. For me, stress reduction is the starting point of dealing with mindfulness or of learning mindfulness. Where it moves is to see how your nervous system operates, right? So are you moving kind of into this state of what we call hyperarousal or fight or flight? And then we know that if you're in that spot, it's also negatively correlated with the quality of intelligence you bring to whatever decision you have to make. Think about what happens when you make a decision when you're angry or frustrated or fearful or anxious, right? How does it happen in a meeting, right? What happens? What's the result? Again, what's the result? Usually not so good. So the first thing that we work with is how do I recognize what's going on in my nervous system, right? What does it feel like when I'm up here? And how can I start to manage it so I come back down to a place where I'm more present, I'm calmer, I can see a wider view, I'm not gonna run away from the thing that scares me or attack it or deny it or whatever, so that I can make a smarter decision. So that's the first step. The second thing is that as you become aware of this process, you start to understand that everybody has experienced some level of pain in their life, and that pain, for good or for ill, influences a lot of decision making. So as the weeks go on, I have to say that in my syllabus, on the first page, in big letters, is a statement that says, please don't take this class, right? Please don't take it because it's really hard, and there are some veterans of this process scattered amongst you, right? Because you have to, you know, you're being put into a situation where you have to really look at the difficult part of your life. And instead of avoiding it or pretending it doesn't happen or project it out onto the people who live with you or work with you, we learn tools, again, going back to how do you fill out an education, we learn tools to learn how to metabolize this pain or difficulty so that it becomes a fuel for the next stage of your growth. Right? So it's a very different way of relating to the world and to what happens. And seeing, you know, not in a kind of masochistic way, but understanding that, you know, that pain, and this is where you know, social science, I think, is really now moving into an interesting area, you know, to see pain and suffering as something that can be transformed into compassion or wisdom or, you know, intelligence. And, you know, touching on, again, on this issue of need and education, for 60, 70 years, at least in the West, our social science has been largely a social science of dysfunction and studying damage and despair and depression and all of those things. We know a lot about how to cause suffering, actually. But we don't know a whole lot about how to transform it. And there is now, in the last 10 or 15 years, an emerging science that shows you can transform your mind. And if I have to plug a book, this book by Sue Smalley and Diana Winston at UCLA at the Mindfulness Center there, called Fully Present, is an excellent kind of compendium of the research now being done on how do you transform the mind. So I think for us, this becomes, if you are facing the super wicked problem as an organization, and of course your survival system is going to activate in this process, and we, instead of reverting back to what we already do, that obviously won't work in this new condition, right? And it's scary. You know, my belief is that managers need to have this skill to be able to transform their own internal terror or fright into fuel for growth and flourishing.
So for me, that this frequency, how we've started to play with it is to describe how to reshape a culture or repattern an organization so that we're tuning the frequency at which it operates. I.e., we're interested in how a culture can more than tolerate, but by design, increase its ability to work with the highs and lows of dancing with the known and the unknown. How is that designed into the organization? How is that designed into how we meet? How is that designed into how we create strategy, et cetera, manage change? And the both tough and delightful part of that dance is the lows are critical and necessary to get to the highs. So how do you intentionally design that in? How do we see too many leaders who, with for good intent, overprotect their people? They don't want them to suffer and to go through pain. But pain is a natural part of change. You don't want to give people pain for the sake of giving people pain. But to deny it is part of growth is a really dangerous thing. It keeps us trapped doing the same patterns. So the lows are critical to the highs. As I said at the beginning, you know, I remember three really big periods in hospital where I, in my adolescence, wasn't sure if I was coming out. I probably was easily coming out, but in my head, I wasn't sure. And in hindsight, those moments were transformational for me. I chose to make different choices in my life. And it's kind of like that moment, it helped me realize, okay, at one level, I stopped fearing death. Doesn't mean I fear a bad death. But the notion of actually how do you get lost, how do you meander, how do you wander is a critical part of the creative process. How to let go. And more importantly then, how do you design moments of breakthrough? So that when you're coming through the dip, when you come up here, you catch a glimpse of something new. By staying in the unknown long enough, not collapsing the tension, the unfamiliarity, the vulnerability of stepping into the unknown, you can create amazing things. So for me, there's the pain of it, but there's the wonder of it as well. Part of this that I would love to see more in education, our foundation works a lot in schools all over the world, is how you teach people, other kids, other ways of knowing, so that you can tolerate ambiguity, you can work with creative tension. And we're very good in organizations collapsing tension prematurely through politeness, you know, through avoidance, through politics, through rumor. These are all ways of avoiding tension and realizing it's a healthy part of the creative process. I've seen some of the most creative organizations I've met, you will see them arguing with each other. They will be fighting their different perspectives with vigor and passion, but they will not take it personally. They're not saying you're having a go at me. It's we're going to hold this tension until something new pops in the space between us because we're in service of something bigger than us individually. So how to stay with the unknown is a really important part of it. And part of what we've been exploring is how do you bring this back to basics? How do you hold the space for newness to emerge in an organization, as a leader, as a team? And I come back to, I think leaders do three things, and particularly executive leaders. Above and beyond, they may have a craft and a speciality and expertise. Their role comes down to three things. They think, they talk, and they don't know it often. They hold or take up space. We all know we think. We often don't think collectively. We ping-pong opinions together and repeat the same old thought pattern. We don't actually think together and generate new thought. We repeat thought. But that's really what great leaders do. They think. They often don't roll up their sleeves and go and make anything. Their skill set is how they think and how they talk to people. That is the skill set of leadership. And often that manifests in meetings, whether it's a one-to-one meeting or a large group meeting or a town hall or a conference. Your art as an executive leader is how you think and how you talk. But the invisible part of that is how you either hold or take up space as a leader. And you do it by default, whether you know it or not. And I think part of the problem of great leaders or good leaders become acknowledged because they are good at taking up space. Often it can be because of their brilliance. They have brains like planets. They can be bright, quick, stunning, and therefore everything else is in service of that brilliance. Or they can take up space through arrogance and ego and attachment to things that they've done before. But both of those don't create a space for something new that taps into the collective intelligence of a group of human beings. So they need to, a challenge is how do leaders move from being at the center to actually creating space? And this comes back to why we put this on the, this word on the whiteboard. Newness only comes from the space between. The space between a thought, the space between tomorrow and yesterday, the space between me and you or us. That is the only place newness comes from. So how do you hold that space as a leader where something can pop? How do you hold the space where you slow people down and get out of the habitual pattern? Because we're very good at habituating a pattern of thought and action and not interrupting it. And this is where we come back to mindfulness, because you have to catch yourself. The problem with newness is it's fragile and it's often momentary. So part of mindfulness or being truly present as a leader is how do you hold the space for long enough and actually catch newness happening? Because often you miss it or you judge it and it disappears. So paying attention to newness, attending to it, and then when you see it, tending it, giving it a chance to actually land and give form, is a critical part of mindfulness and of leadership. And if we're going to create new patterns of thought that lead to new patterns of action up here, which we desperately need, by the way, we need to be present, because without being present, you don't see new pattern. It is a critical correlation. You can't be present, you don't see something new emerge. You just repeat what you've always seen and said.
This week in class, I realized that largely what we do is to help people create space. So let's give a concrete example. One of my younger students said, I had an argument with someone, and I'm really angry at them, and I don't want to talk to them anymore. And so, her nervous system got activated. The flight response got activated, and she's creating all these stories about what a venal person this is and how, I don't need them in my life anymore and all of that. And so, just like we asked you to do, I asked her, okay, you have all these stories in your head. That's your narrative. What's happening in your body? Right? Let's not try to overthink it. What's happening in your body? And she says, I notice there's this tension here, right? And my heart's racing. And we sat with it for a little bit, just sit with it. just for a little bit. Don't try to make it go away. Don't try to, you know, turn it into balloons that fly away or something like that, you know. Just sit with it. Notice what happens. And then she sat with it, wasn't comfortable, right? And then gradually it started to calm down. And I said, okay, what do you think about this situation? And she kind of looked down at the floor and she said, well, actually, it's really, if I'm really honest, I really want this person in my life, right? And, but I don't know what to do. So, you know, what we do is, you know, there's an emotional reaction. And we have an action, right? This emotional reaction happens, right? I feel angry. And then right here's the moment I take action, right? At my least intelligence, my point of least intelligence. And then that action, I take action, and that brings about a result. And if at this moment of least intelligence, the result is usually not the one we want, right, in the long run. And so what mindfulness does is to create space between this emotional reaction and the action. It's one of the things it does, right, or helps us do. We talked a lot about, in that same conversation, you know, we kind of expanded it to the whole class. Okay, think of the difficult person in your life. Right, a difficult colleague. What was interesting is that everybody had one, right? It's like nobody said, well, you know, I can't participate in this exercise because I don't really have any difficult people. And think of the difficult person. It's okay. And then I asked, did anybody have an image of that person as a happy person, right? Nobody did, because the image they had of the difficult person was them being difficult. So another way of creating space was to say, you know, when Nick talks about, you know, the reaction collapses, right? In this case, our reaction around the difficult person collapses in on an image of them as difficult, which is not their totality as a human being, right? There are other aspects of them. But in our habitual patterning, we create this picture of this venal, evil person I don't need to be with, and I create all these stories and have all kinds of emotional reactions around. Okay, what if we can create space around that story and approach it from a different point of view? Right? What are the other aspects of this person that you're not considering? And how does that create space around your relationship to that person that can change the action we can take, which can bring about a different sort of result? So for us, I think, you know, space is essential. In the last year, and especially the last 6 months, the conversation of having with executives have taken on a different sort of tone. And I have to say, it sounds almost like desperation in a way. Right, that the amount of information coming at me, the fact that my, you know, devices are always on, and, you know, at 10 o'clock I get a note from my boss saying, when are you going to respond to this, right? And then at 7 o'clock when I wake up, there's another note that says, you haven't responded to this yet, right? That the interpenetration of work life and home life has become, you know, in a way seamless or boundaryless. And so the space we have just to be has collapsed, in a sense. And you know, anybody who studies biology knows that the way a cell wall can survive is that it negotiates what comes in the cell and what goes out of the cell. And we haven't, what we've done in our lives, I think, is remove the cell wall. So there's no negotiation about what comes in and comes out. And we feel overwhelmed and desperate in that condition, I think. What was interesting in this group of executives that I talked with a few weeks ago, in asking them about, in their meetings, for example, do they have policies around devices, right? Like, do you have a policy that says, when you're in a meeting, please leave your device at your desk, right? so that you can attend to what's happening. And in a group of 18 senior executives from 18 different firms, what was interesting is that almost every one of them did have a policy, right? So I think that we are in this kind of freakishly overwhelming situation we find ourselves in, people are starting to adapt. Companies are starting to adapt to say, look, we need to create space, you know, in the way we work, in the way we meet, in the way we converse, and starting to adapt policies around how are we actually going to use these things, right? So in a very practical way, you know, how do we create space? What do you think?
And continue this notion of practicality. For me, we see a number of pressure points of how cultures play out. Cultures are the way we do things. And the way we do things in organizations is often we have a way of meeting, we have a way of doing strategy, we have just things are the way we do it. And we become blind to there are other ways of doing it. And actually teaching organizations to learn how to ride this roller coaster, to actually hold a meeting where you're working with both the known and the unknown. How do you get the known in the room quicker? Because people keep the known in their back pocket. It's a safety net. How do you get the known out so that we can collectively leap into the unknown? And when you do that, you need a different space. You need to sit differently. You need to realize time is different. You have to create space to go into the unknown. Similarly with strategy, you can have analytics to the cows come home, but it just repeats the same pattern of data. You need the discontinuous leap of thought to create a new strategy. So what are the ways in which you strategize so something emerges rather than the figures tell you the answer? There's a really important and beautiful side to this challenge of bringing more of this dance into work, into life, is that it is richer. You have a richer experience, individually and collectively. For me, wonder comes back into life. You surprise yourself with what you can achieve, which is really, really important. Not only can, when you bring these types of ways of working and thinking into organizations, create better productivity, better innovation. The number of times, thank God, because it's what I get paid to do, a team would walk away from a workshop and go, we wouldn't have been able to do this in 3 months or 6 months, we did it in 3 days. It's because of a different way of thinking and relating to each other. And they go out going, I want to do that again. And so they move towards it. It's like having a peak experience and saying, I want to go back to that again. Because it's tapped into more of me. I feel like I've contributed more, I've listened more, I've actually created something that's bigger than me, and it's undeniable. So whilst I think there's a challenge of the dip, which it can be perceived as painful and unfamiliar, if you learn to ride it, it's enormously enriching. And the challenge for me, bringing the word you brought earlier, is education. How do you get this? I mean, I can work with executives, but I would wish that we could teach 5-year-olds, 10-year-olds, 15-year-olds, how to work with the unknown, not get freaked out by it. But what are the skills around identity and stillness and appreciation that allow you to stay there more often and to relish staying in the unknown for periods of time? For me, that's the next challenge, not just business, it's in education. And for me, you then get into the magic of it and where we came back to the body work at the beginning. Mindfulness comes through the body. Leadership comes through us. It's a physical activity. And it's by paying attention to being truly present, when you start to feel something new has emerged, it first registers in your body, not in your head. Is your energy going up? Do you see a repetition? Your unconscious speaks to you, doesn't speak to you in language, it speaks to you in repetition, in energy. And when you raise your awareness to that, then you get into the world of synchronicity. Things start to reveal themselves. That's when you're holding space for newness to emerge. So let's bring it full circle. What we want to do is just end with, how are we in the room? We'd like to just you spend maybe 60 seconds just in your own, getting back into your body, because you'll be masters if you haven't left them and gone into your head at some extent. What's been happening? Can you remember moments in the last 45 minutes where your energy was up, you were triggered by something you agreed with or disagreed with? Just maybe spend 60 seconds softening your body again, getting into the right space for something. See what is emerging for you. What is that space within you? Because if you don't open a space within you, you can't hold a space for others to step into. It's as basic as that. If there's no space in a leader, they cannot hold a space for other people to step in and to invite and invoke the higher self of someone else to come into a relationship with you. So, just for 60 seconds. Don't judge what emerges. Don't make meaning of what emerges. Just notice what is emerging in your body. Okay, 60 seconds is a lot longer than you think. And the danger is always try and fill that silence or collapse that silence. What we'd invite you to do, by the way, it's just an option, is we'd like you to just pair up with someone. If you've come with someone, that's great. If you haven't come with someone, don't worry, this isn't going to be too tricky, but we want to play with space again, just to complete this session. So could you just kind of somehow orientate, who are you going to pair up with, or there's a trio of... And if you don't want to do it, just acknowledge you don't want to do it. Just pair up, and then I'll give you the instructions. Take a risk. We're all human. Okay? If you're ready, just step over this threshold for just a few minutes. You can collapse it straight after. Okay, here's the instruction. This is an exercise called STEMS. It's a way in which you can embody in action a way of thinking, a way of speaking, and a way of holding space together. Okay? It's really not a conversation. One person is going to speak for 60 seconds and the other person listens. And then when I ding my bell, ding, you'll swap roles. The other person will speak and the other person will listen. And then we're complete. And if you've got energy, we'll do another one. Okay? But we're going to just jump into it. It's called STEMS, and sorry, I've only scribbled it on here. There, STEMS is the completion of a sentence that isn't complete. And there are three in this order. Something that is emerging in me is. What am I noticing that is emerging in me as I stop, reflect, get into this space? So it's an act of disclosure to the other person, which is edgy if you don't know them. So what's this what are you opening through the act of disclosure? The second stem is something I intuit about you is. This is slightly more edgy. And let's bearing in mind, this is not constructive feedback. This is probably some level of appreciation or noticing that's positive. Okay, you have not got permission to give any other type of feedback. So your intent is to unlock something. But tune in. Just trust what is emerging is an intuition about that other person. Your third one is a stem, which is something I notice about the space between us is. How can you raise your attention to the space between you? Okay? Now, this is simply 60 seconds. 60 seconds is a long time where one person is going to complete. Do not complete these three sentences in 10 seconds. It is not very mindful. Your job in that 60 seconds is to open the space between you. So it possibility, something new could arise. Shape the space by how you speak, how you relate, through the act of disclosure, feedback, and noticing. It's an experiment. It can go wrong. Okay? Just don't hit each other. Okay? Notice your own reactions as the receiver. You know, what is it like to receive, to listen, to take someone else in? It's not a passive action. But you're not supposed to speak. It's not a conversation. Now, the best way to do it is just to do it. Okay? So, best also to stand up. Because how it comes through you is very different when you're standing and attending to someone than sitting and turning with an awkward, bad health and safety movement. Okay, so if you could just stand up. Attend to that person. And I will give you 60 seconds. Choose who's going to go first. Your intent here is to play with the space between you. You are unlocking space. Are you ready? We're just going to go for it. Ready? First person answering the three stems, 60 seconds. Here's the intent. Ready? Off you go. About 15 seconds to go. Okay, ding. Now swap roles. About 10 seconds.
Particularly the girls. Socially, not stand to
Okay, if you'd like to finish off, You can give each other a hug if you really want, but you don't have to if you don't want. Okay. So, just quick. A few seconds. Talk amongst yourselves, tell a joke. How was that? 60-second conversation. It's not even a conversation, it's giving in 60 seconds. What were you noticing? What was happening for you? Let's get a quick shout out, maybe, because we want to move on to something quickly.
How much of a connection you can make with another person in just 60 seconds?
From the act of leadership, you can make a difference in 60 seconds as you walk past someone, as you bump into them. So I'm going to invite you, I know we're slightly over time, but our instinct is, why don't you have one other go at doing it with someone else? Another 2 minutes, just because it's the practice of it. Mindfulness is a practice. It's not just a nice concept and exercise. If you could partner up with someone else, no accident, who could you partner up with? And practice how to use that 60 seconds. Okay? If you find someone else or see if, pay attention if there's someone who hasn't partnered up yet. Look and invite someone to join you. Okay, when you're ready, 60 seconds, you know the rules, go. About 10 seconds before you switch. Okay, ding. Switch roles. About 10 seconds. Okay, if you can wrap it up, hopefully you're still speaking to each other. Hugs are optional. When you're done, you're done. Please take a seat.
So, question, what do you notice happening in your body?
Relaxation and strength. And it just built the more we're talking.
So the relaxation built the more you engaged, yeah.
Absolutely, and just feeling stronger and taller.
Huh. Yeah. Beautiful. Someone else? So, right here.
I'm so sorry. Feeling energized.
Feeling energized.
Releasing.
Releasing.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I was just thinking the word engaged, more engaged all the time.
I just found these exercises to be something like improv we used to do, which kind of you have to stop thinking and just, you know, be in the moment and release. It's fun. Good stuff.
So you can see it's not, one more, please. Oh.
With my second exercise, I got teary-eyed, and I'm like, why? And I think part of it is like I almost didn't come because I had so many things to do, but then I came with a friend. And then I thought, like, we could watch it online. But then, no, being there would be different. So being with a stranger and with my friend and then a stranger, it just made me teary looking at their eyes.
In the second one, it was really a question at the end of how do you capture this and go forward? And is there anything that you do in your workshop, basically, that helps that team take this energy as they walk out of the room?
So most of our work is how to craft creative teams. So they're often working on questions they really don't have the answer to, and we need a breakthrough. And an exercise like this is a great exercise as we're warming up, so people start to deepen quality of contact. And by deepening contact, you create the field conditions that increase trust. But for me, this is a leaping off point. This is, in a creative team, let's say we had 10 people in a team, you do not get true breakthrough unless at least 90% of those relationships are flowing. So this is an unblocking mechanism at a very quick level, where you can do it with a whole team. You know, actually you can stand in a circle and have short conversations with every member to charge the team energetically and relationally so that it now has the relationship to leap into the unknown. So this is a prep tool, because when they go into the unknown in these workshops, it can be over hours, it can also be over weeks and months, depending upon how big the challenge is. So they need to keep coming back to cleaning the energy of their relationships, because anything that gets in the way, any funk, any, you know, tension is going to just collapse it. So taking the funk out of relationship is really important. Otherwise, it just collapses and you can waste weeks.
So we'd like to turn it back to you. What are questions or thoughts, experiences you'd like to share? Please.
I'm Kathy. Is there a book or a workbook that gives us questions that would stimulate some of this on our own?
It's outside in the lobby. Discounted.
I have what might be called kind of a complex societal problem. I'm very active in the environmental field, and one of the major problems you have is the adversarial relationship between government regulators, government entities that have to deal with the business world. And we see, for example, in West Virginia recently, the drinking water crisis created by the fact that government has been ineffective in regulating a private industry. And we see this over and over again. So if I'm a regulator, or you're a regulator, or someone else is a regulator, how do you deal with this? Of course, there's lawsuits, there's regulations, and so on. There's also attempts at negotiated conversations and agreements between government regulators and the private sector. But oftentimes, the private sector has superior resources, whether it be financial, political, or whatever. So I guess the question is, if you or I are working for a regulatory agency, how can we be effective in bringing some of these techniques to our conversations and interactions with the private world for the betterment of society.
It's a brilliant question. I wish I had an easy answer. It triggers two thoughts that maybe is a contribution to it. The first one is, if I go back to the theme that hopefully is something that we've been able to thread all the way through, is the ability, so a lot of my work is how to help organizations and bring even just the diversity within a team or within an organization into co-creative relationship. You can't be in creative relationship until you value difference. It's just a fundamental DNA. If you give up your difference in relationship, you go into a subservient relationship, not a creative relationship. And what we've been experimenting for 20 years is how you do that in teams, in organizations, cross functions. A big pull in the last 10 years is how do you do that across value chains and ecosystems, where you can work tri-sector. You start to get government, non-government, corporate working together. And you can create the space for breakthrough. If you have the right leaders who are willing to step into a more vulnerable space. I personally think that governments is one of my areas I'm really interested in, is I would love to, from a design perspective, how do you redesign governance in a way that creates containers where different parties can come together? So I don't have an answer of how do you do that yet. I think we know the principles, but I haven't done it. What your question also triggers for me is another dilemma I think we're facing, which is I see a lot of, how to explain it. There are a lot of thought leaders out there and experts who are wanting to make the world a better place. They're passionate about whether it's oceanography or, you know, saving the seas or whatever the big topics are, and there's lots of them. They have great wisdom about what the problem is and great passion about trying to do something different. Unfortunately, they don't have the power to make the decisions. So you have the thought leaders, and then you have the leaders, who actually are the decision makers. And there's too many places who believe that just by putting thought leaders and leaders in a room, something new will happen. It doesn't. They bounce off each other, and they repeat the same conversation. So for me, I wish I had a clear answer, but I think the challenge here is now, how do you help this third capacity be built? I think it's also maybe a third group of people, a third conscience group, that know how to bring people difference together and different worldviews together where they can create a meta worldview. And it's all about slowing people down to actually first of all see each other and appreciate each other. Otherwise, you can't create and find a new solution. So, you know, we're seeing regulators come together now in creative, you know, we're doing work with the EU, working with corporates. It's starting to happen, and they're starting to pull it because having the same old conversations is not good enough. So it's beginning. I haven't got a blueprint yet.
Hi, Jeremy, how are you? Just a question for maybe Jeremy and for Nick. What have you found in your experience has been the biggest stumbling block for individuals to create that practice of mindfulness or to be able to create that space as a practical matter on the level of the individual and then also on the level of organization? Just in your experience, what are some of the things that you've seen that has come up that's been the most, the greatest impediment of being able to take this practice and make it effective in their lives?
Just to clarify, to sustain a practice in your life? Yeah. How to sustain a practice?
To make it effective, translate it into
result. Okay, so how to sustain a practice and then how to make it effective to translate it into result. One, I think, how do you create a structure of support? So whether it's simply a habit, you know, so we know with behavior change, start with small increments, maybe a minute of just being quiet for this week, and then next week, 2 minutes. And so that you gradually build in a kind of neural wiring that makes it easier to fall into that. What I do is create spatial reminders in where I live for practicing. So I put the place where I do my practice right in the middle of our living room. So I have to see it. I think I'm very fortunate to be married to a woman who is incredibly mindful. And so I think having a partner, it doesn't have to be a life partner, but having somebody who you can support and supports you, sustaining that is important. So it's not necessarily just an individual practice. So that's a kind of mechanics thing. I think another thing is fear. What gets in the way of a person really looking inside is the terror of what they might see. And I think understanding that as we talked about earlier, that's really fuel for growth. And I have a student right now who's going through a really hard set of experiences. And the thing we talked about, one-on-one, is to say, understand that this painful experience you're going through right now is at some level a teaching. And it's asking you to be in the world in a different way, let go of something, or step into an unknown space to try something. And I think, I think we're definitely in agreement with that, that you need at some level, you need lows to really propel you to highs. And that too smooth a life is not one that necessarily leads to greatness, I think.
So. I was just going to have one question but let me just quickly answer that one. What comes to mind is the art of holding a question. Actually, it's really easy to solve a question, but to answer a question, but to find a great question and to learn how to hold it and to walk through life holding questions. It increases your curiosity, and as that curiosity is maintained, your vitality increases. And I think that's a really good practice for individuals to move into a great question is a way of moving into the unknown with intent. And the art of it is not to solve the question, but to see what emerges. Therefore, you are training yourself in emergence. And another question emerges, and then you follow that question. And I think it also comes back to the businesses I'm seeing really shaping the future, is their leadership team are not putting answers into the organization, they're putting brilliant questions into an organization. And it's really difficult to craft a great question. We could brainstorm now and come up with lots of great questions, we'll walk away really buzzed, and tomorrow, we'll look back at them and go, pretty rubbish. They don't hold their energy. To craft a question that holds energy over weeks and months is a high art. And for me, that's a critical practice. I think we've got time for one more.
Thank you for this wonderful talk and exercise. My question is, what are your experiences with different cultures, especially in organizations who are multiple cultures? What are your experiences?
So I would describe our practice as a liberating discipline. If I go back to the Zen roots, I was fascinated how the disciplines constrain you with intent and increase the pressure until something pops. And we started this practice in Europe and some extent also in the US. And we would have clients in Europe turn around and say, this will never work in our Asian part of the business. It will never work in Japan, it will never work in China. And then they'd also say, it will never work in Latin America. And it's interesting that, and I'll be very mindful that I don't want to stereotype, but because I think this is a consciousness practice, not a behavioral one, you see in Asia where there is a cultural tendency that discipline is the norm as opposed to expression and liberation. And it's the opposite in Latin America, full of expression, but not a lot of discipline. It's finding that sweet spot where you're working across, almost the cultures disappear when you're working with liberating disciplines. So this practice brings them into a relationship where you dance between expression and discipline. Creativity is not white space, it's constraint. And then it's having the ability to express yourself as the tension increases. So I haven't yet found a significant difference of cultures riding that. If you give them the other part of the equation, they can do it. It's quite effortless. And moreover, then you get to the next level where you can put these cultures into really creative relationship with each other, where they start to see, and I'm careful of this, diversity. I don't mean it from its political correctness, but diversity for the sense of valuing and seeing difference is the building block for something new to happen.
Well, thank you very much for joining us in our experiment. And thank you, Nick.
Thank you, Jeremy.
And I want to thank you all for coming this morning. I think this has been a terrific program, and I thank Nick and Jeremy for putting this together and being here today. And I just want to say on behalf of the Southern California Public Radio Crawford Family Forum, you're welcome back anytime. We'd love to see you.